Hi, Carmel. Thanks for joining me this morning.
Hi, Lisa. Nice to see you.
Oh, yes, that's a shame it has to be like this, but there you go. So, can you introduce yourself and tell us a bit about your involvement with the creative arts?
So I'm Carmel, and I work at Base Camp in Middlesbrough, which is a multi-arts venue in the heart of the historic quarter. We're in a Grade 2 listed building, which poses some challenges, but we've managed to overcome them. And we are just looking forward to getting reopened again.
Yeah, I mean it was lucky it's this I mean we started this interview project in July, so it's been such a journey. It's like we thought we were coming out, and one of the few things that I managed to make it along to was your opening of your you kind of turned outside into a venue, didn't you?
Yes, we did. We opened the August bank holiday weekend, so later than a lot of venues, but we just felt we just needed to make sure all our procedures were in place and we could keep everybody safe. So we opened from August, so the last weekend in August we did a It's Not Leeds festival, which was kind of an experiment into the new way of doing things. So we turned our huge warehouse into a big socially distanced bar and staged a lot of gigs there. So we did gigs most weekends until Halloween when we were shut down again. And I have to say it was really successful. Everything sold out, obviously hugely reduced capacity. We did some films, we did quizzes. And we didn't have a single case of COVID, so I was really proud of us for that. And then we've been spending the last lockdown planning for 2021. Obviously, there's light at the end of the tunnel now, so we can start to think we might actually be able to stage some larger events. So that's what we've been up to.
Yeah, I mean, for me, the Red Room that I did down at Base Camp in February was the last creative event that I put on, and Girl 2020 was the last performance that I gave out in the real world. So yeah, it's been it's been great to see your resilience, and it's been great to see that there's like tell us a bit about the work that you've done on the building itself over lockdown.
Okay, so the first lockdown, obviously the building is it's a beast of a building. It needs a lot of love. So we just did a lot of painting, we spruced it up, we like I say, we really worked on the warehouse, which had been quite, kind of scruffy. So we prettied that up a bit. We got a lot of new furniture because obviously all the table service thing meant huge map tables. And yeah, we just kind of, oh, we opened a recording studio upstairs, a practice room for bands, sidecar studios. So we did that. Then in this lockdown, we have decided we're going to start doing food. So getting a kitchen fitted. Well, we're very good at sourcing things on a budget. So we found a load of, secondhand stuff that was being auctioned off. So got ourselves a kitchen, or we are in the process of getting a kitchen, and we'll be doing vegan and veggie food. So hopefully that'll count as the substantial meal. But it also means we'll be able to open, during the day more as a kind of cafe or a meeting place, or for people to come and work who've been working from home for months. So we're just trying to stay optimistic and cheerful and be, remain enthusiastic.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's I think we all have moments where we might get a bit shouty and sweary about things, and moments where we just hang our heads, but ultimately we just need to keep going, whatever happens. And I do think that people that work in the creative industries are probably more well prepared for what's happened than a lot of people that have kind of always thought the world is stable and unchanging. So at least I think we were a bit more prepared for it. So how did you get into all of this? Have you always been involved in the creative arts since you were young, or has this been something that's happened later on?
No, well, I started life, I did a degree in film at UEA in Norwich in the 80s, and then I moved into journalism. So I was a journalist for 10, 12 years, something like that. But I covered the local music scene for the Gazette for years and years and years. So I've always been massively into music. Then I went off and worked in PR for 10 years, was a creative director for an agency. And then when my daughters were born, I just wanted something that I could do around them, really. So Graham, my husband, has 10 feet tall. So I started working alongside him, did some comedy shows, bits and pieces, PR for him. And then, but this is the first time we've had our own venue, and it's fabulous. I love it. Absolutely love it. It kind of feels like a culmination of all those different aspects coming together. And it's just brilliant to, you know, be around live performances all the time.
Yeah, absolutely. And interesting, it's like I've got a few cases, myself being one of basically recovering others, finding a new path for themselves. And certainly for me, the arts was something that I did in my spare time at my own expense, you know, the way that people think the arts is done. For most of my life, I was kind of working full time and subsidising the arts really through that work. And it was only really, you know, being at home for 5 years, looking after little kids and trying to go back into the workplace and realizing that my career was ripped to pieces. It was in shreds and I would never earn anything like I was. I was, you know, I was going back to work for on a third of the wage that I'd been on. And so making the decision to go to university, and it's completely changed my life. And it's, you know, particularly this job I have here right now is just so fulfilling and a complete honour to be doing it. So yeah, it's interesting the different paths that people have taken to get themselves to this place. And also, like, people from the younger generation seem to have been encouraged to fulfil their dreams and do what they love rather than do the sensible subjects and get a proper job. Because, you know, as far as I can see, the creative arts is a massively proper job. You know, there's 2 million of us employed in the creative industries, and I hope we can become a bit more self-aware and get a bit more of a voice as we come out of lockdown. Because, as you say, it's like incredibly difficult for venues, particularly the smaller venues, that are wet venues, I suppose, as the politicians would call it. And, you know, you have got the space down there, and, you know, places like the Auxiliary also, and Pineapple Black, there's all this room that I don't see why they haven't been allowed to open. And let's hope that that changes. I hope there's some momentum builds up, because we can't afford to lose these venues at all. Have you got the whole of next year planned out? Are you just sort of like waiting at the moment to see when the North's allowed out to play again, playing it by ear?
We are a little bit. I mean, we're planning a virtual festival, a monthly festival, Celebrate Everything, which will start in January. I'm hoping that'll become real world in spring, but to be honest, we've been so, you know, each time they announce new kind of rules, you kind of tie yourselves in knots trying to make everything secure, and then 2 weeks later they change the rules again, and it's just kind of, it's a very difficult plan. So I suppose I'm imagining that kind of when the weather gets a bit better, we can at least go outside, so we'll be able to do some things outside if we can't do them inside. So I guess we're thinking, you know, spring really. But yeah, we've got lots of different festivals planned. We've got you know, we haven't booked bands, we haven't booked films, we've got lots of people waiting for dates, and we just keep saying, you know, we had a big dance event that was supposed to be happening in January, obviously that's kind of on hold. We've got a group of female artists who are doing an exhibition about the experience of women in lockdown, but again we're just kind of waiting and hoping that we'll get perhaps a little bit of notice before we're actually allowed to open.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, that's a real shame, and particularly with the dance, it's like I didn't realise until this project how much is going on in dance in Teesside, and so you know, I'm really keen to champion that. I've met some fantastic people involved in all kinds of different art forms relating to dance. So I do hope, and I think you're absolutely right about outdoors. I think feel really gutted that we kind of wasted last summer, because we could have all been outside, we could have all been doing stuff, and I'm determined that even if it's completely impromptu, I've got like a wheelable PA thing that's got a 6-hour charge, so you know, just rock up in any outdoor space and just turn it into a performance space and keep it going that way. But as you say, it would be nice to have some idea of what's going on. I mean, I know it's completely unpredictable, and that's not their fault, but you know, still some of it just seems incomprehensible.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. But I don't know, we just have to, I suppose, we'll, it's quite hard to stay motivated when you have, you know, sticky finger in the air. Is it going to be April? Is it going to be July? Is it going to, you know, it is very difficult, but we've got a brilliant team, and you know, we've kind of kept each other sane, I think, and you know, there is light now. I think we can see it, that hopefully by the end of next year we will be fully operational again, fingers crossed.
Yeah, absolutely. I really hope so, and let's hope we can all hold on until that time, and all get back at us. Like, you know, I think it is, you know, for individual artists, I think it's actually been a really productive time. People have appreciated the opportunity to step back and think about their creative practice and think about the way they want to go, and you know, when they're writers, to get the writing done, but you know, the venues are the people that have really suffered. And they're so important, the little venues as well as the big venues. It's like about that sliding scale of opportunity for development. It's like David Byrne wrote about the music scene. In order for that to work, you've got to have, like, you know, place like Disgraceland, like the really small venues where you hone your craft. Like, it's one of the few times I've been out, and Chaz Thomas played down there, and you know, he played to like, you know, maybe 10 of us, but it was just so brilliant to be out, and it was so informal that he got to the end of his set and we're like, let's start again from the top. And that amount of interaction with your audience and seeing what works and what doesn't, you know, and being able to try things out, that's what brings on artists, what's how they grow, that's how they move up through the venues. And if you take out those bottom rungs, the smaller venues, then how do you ever get to the top? Absolutely. You know, I mean, I know there's things like X Factor and stuff these days, but you know, for in the real world, that's what we need. We need all of our venues. We need to save them all, and you know, and I'm determined to make sure that we do. You know, however long it takes, we must. We must, because it was, you know, Teesside, the whole scene was blossoming, wasn't it? I mean, it really was taking off. It was looking so good.
No, I mean, there was so much energy. And like you say, you know, just from the kind of disgrace lines and the, you know, all the stuff going on at Auxiliary and Pineapple Black. I mean, it was really felt exciting. Like, the, you know, kind of people travelling from outside the area to Middlesbrough. which, you know, 5 years ago you'd never have seen. And then it just does feel like, you know, everyone's had the rug pulled out from underneath them. And, you know, fingers crossed everybody manages to survive and come back fighting. And because I think that the support will be phenomenal, you know, when people are allowed to go out again. I think people will realize just how much those venues mean to people.
Absolutely. Well, you know, I kind of wish this had been a little bit more upbeat, but we've got to be honest about the situation we're in. You know what I mean? It's like no point pretending that it's all fun and games, because it's not. And livelihoods are on the line here, and venues are under threat. And if there are any, you know, rich folk out there, like, that have made millions through the arts, wherever my camera is speaking, like just give these people your money, you know, give all of our artists all your money, and make sure that they can survive through lockdown, because you know you'll miss them. That was the first bit of campaigning I've done through these interviews. Carmel, it's been really lovely to talk to you, and I can't wait to get back down to base camp and raise a glass and a Scotch egg or something with you guys.
Absolutely, yeah, brilliant. All right, thanks, Lisa. Bye.
Thank you.